three or four people on one bike. You don't have a family car, you have a family motorbike. But this is a reminder that travel in Nepal, as Debbie is saying, is a risky business. The roads aren't very good, and the mountains are very high, and the valleys, you know, very narrow, lots of steep sides, and it's a really good thing to pray for. I have to travel a lot with my work, and just getting around is risky. So we are thankful, you know, especially at this time of New Year, as we look back on the last year, we're thankful for safety, and it's good to pray for safe travel in the future. Okay, next photo.
Right, so quick look, and then the question is, do they both have necklaces?
Yes.
No. Confident yes, confident no.
One of them has one.
Definitely one of them has. Let's have a look, shall we?
Yes.
Yeah, they both have necklaces. They do. And the bonus question is, any idea what their job might be? Yes?
Farmers.
It's a good guess because many, many people do a bit of farming, and they probably do grow a bit of stuff. Yes?
They make jewellery.
That's a good guess as well. They probably made their own necklaces, but then it's not what they do for their main work. So they, you go back to the picture, they actually carried our bags for us when we went walking in the mountains. And they're porters. And Nepali people are small, but they're very strong. And you'll know some of them are in the British Army. And they're tough. And they live in the mountains, and they're tough and they're strong. And they have to do whatever work they can to get by. And so these women do portering, and they carry bags for people travelling, or they might carry stuff to deliver because there aren't roads to all the different villages. And these two are from a Buddhist background. So most people in Nepal are Hindu. These two were Buddhist, but they actually became Christians, and they were sharing with us as we walked about how they'd found out about Jesus and decided to follow Jesus. Okay, next picture.
So, the question here is, any ideas what that man is doing? You can go back and have a look if you want. It's not so easy to see.
It's a sewing machine.
It's a sewing machine, that's right, old Singer sewing machine. And this actually is a photo of one of the patients. So I work for a charity called the International Nepal Fellowship, and we run some hospitals. And this is one of our patients, and he suffered from an illness called leprosy. And have you heard of that? And leprosy, you can cure leprosy, but some people, if you've had leprosy for a long time, are left with disability, and it's hard to get a job, and especially in a society like Nepal, which might be, you know, because you've had leprosy, you've done something wrong in your life, and you've been punished. And so part of INF's work, not only do we help on the treatment side, but we also help people to get a job after they've recovered. And this guy's learned how to sew, and this is him busy at work. So, we can move on to the next photo.
Okay, and the question is, what is the woman carrying? Pepper goes, it looks like a wardrobe. It is a wardrobe. And we see people carrying all sorts of things. We're going to show a short video later, and you'll see at the end of that someone just walking down the street with a fridge on their back. These are just things we've picked up as we've been out and about. So she's obviously getting a new wardrobe, moving a wardrobe, but the bonus question is, what might have happened to the house?
A bomb? It could have been a bomb, it's not.
Landslide.
There are lots of landslides in Nepal because the rain comes very suddenly and washes down. Yes?
Earthquake.
Could have been an earthquake. Do you remember 2.5 years ago there was a huge earthquake? Yeah? Yeah, it wasn't an earthquake though. It's where the river should be. That's the clue. So where we're walking and where she's walking is where the riverbed is. And the rain comes mostly in the summer, and so that will be full of water. But now it's dried up, it's in the winter. But what had happened is the rain came so much and so quickly that it just flooded. And all down the side of the riverbank, houses were just literally chopped in half as the river widened. And but it could have been an earthquake, it could have been a landslide. All those things happened in Nepal. It's a very fragile country. And so life is tough. And what we're trying to do through the organisation Chris works with is to help people build their resilience, to be prepared for when things happen, to have houses that are a bit stronger, or to know what they would do in an emergency and disaster. Okay,
picture. So the question here is, do you know what kinds of flowers these are? You gardeners here in Britain? Just shout out. Marigolds. We have a gardening expert. That's right. These are marigolds. And do you know what Nepalis would use these for?
Garlands,
yeah. You can actually, in that basket in the middle of the photo is a garland, which is like a big necklace of marigolds. And what they use those for is if you have a special visitor or you want to honour somebody, you would present them with a garland and they would wear them. And Nepal is a society where there's a very strong sense of respect, and you respect your parents and your elders and those in high position. So there's a lot of, you know, the garland makers are never out of business. There's a lot of respecting to do. And that's a big, you know, that's something that we have to be mindful of as we live there, how to respect their way of doing things. Okay.
Okay. So this is Tabea, our daughter, and Josh, our youngest. And the question is, the question is the most imaginative name for the goat, based on that. So let's go back to the goat. And I'll tell you what other churches have come up with. What did you say?
Big ears.
Yes, that's kind of, he has definitely got very dominant ears. What did you say?
Lock ears.
Eeyore. That's a good idea.
Nibbles.
Well, he's very cute, isn't he? So, I was just talking to Stephanie here about our children and how life is quite different for them from their lives. They get to experience wonderful things that they wouldn't have the opportunity to here. So this was us going on a trek in the foothills of the Himalayas, walking in the mountains, and it's a wonderful experience and a real opportunity. And they meet people from all over the world, so not just Nepalis, but people who are coming to work there from other countries, and that's really fun for them. But there's some things they miss as well. They miss seeing their cousins. They don't see their cousins very often, and their grandparents. They can't do all the different things that you get to do maybe at school here or in extra clubs and so on. So there are pros and cons, but we're really thankful that they've enjoyed life in Nepal, and they're doing really well. So we're thankful for that. But life is different for them in many ways. Okay, this is our last picture.
This is the last photo. It's quite hard to see the photo, but the question is, what do you think these people are doing? We can go back to the photo. Trying to get on the bus. They are not trying to get on the bus. Any other ideas?
Trying to get on a train.
Trying to get on a train?
Yeah.
No.
Not going to work.
It's a pretty. Yeah, we're getting closer now. It's a march, but not a protest march. It's a celebration. Yeah, this is getting really close now. Yeah, it's a kind of. This is actually a celebration march, you could say, and a pilgrimage. We took this on Easter Day, and this is actually Christians walking through the streets of Kathmandu, celebrating Easter. And what churches, they have the church is young there, it's only 60 years old, but what they do on Easter is they meet early in the morning in their own church, and then they, after their service, they start walking towards the centre of town, and the other churches join in, and you have thousands of people meeting. And it's a very joyful, loud, these are mostly people in their 20s or 30s, lots of singing and dancing. And it's just, I just want to encourage you that the church in Nepal is growing very fast, probably the fastest or the second fastest in the world. It's very exciting. It's a very young church. But we're also facing some difficulty. This year we were asked by our pastor not to go on the march because the political situation is a bit more tense and they didn't want to attract more attention by having Westerners there. And they passed a law in the government just a few months ago banning conversion, so you're not allowed to change your religion in Nepal now. And we don't really know what's going to happen with that. Nothing particularly has changed on the ground yet, but there is now the provision in Nepali law to prosecute against people that change religion. So, fantastic church growth, but some opposition there as well, so good things to pray for. So, that's the end of our quiz. I hope that gives you just a little taste of some things, and we'll tell you some more in the second. Okay.
I think we're going to stand and sing.
We're going to sing. He's got the whole world in his hand, which seemed a very suitable song to sing today. And whilst we sing this, the offering is going to be taken. And then when we've had our offering prayer, which I presume you're doing, don't you? Yeah, then the children can go out to paradise. So let's stand and sing. He's got the whole world in his hand.
Thank you, Father, that all good gifts come from you, and thank you for this chance to give back some good provision you've given us, and just pray for the gifts, whether they're financial, or people giving in time, or their skills and talents. Just bless this offering now, Lord. Well, I just pray for the children and young people, and they can go out. Father, thank you for our youngsters, thank you for the great part they are in this church. Just pray that you'll be with them this morning in Powerbase, and you'll give them a time of blessing, and also a time of blessing for the leaders too, Lord, as they learn more about you and enjoy time together, Father. Amen. Okay, children, young people like to leave us.
So there are many ways of sharing God's love, and the BMS birthday scheme is one of them. Elaine is the current birthday scheme secretary, so if you have any questions about it, you can go to her. So here's a short video explaining what it is.
Well, hey, it's your birthday!
Happy birthday. People are singing, you're getting lots of cards and presents. It's all very nice. But what if we flipped it around? I mean, the greatest gift is given, right? So this year, why not share your birthday with someone on the other side of the world by becoming part of a BMS birthday team? Here's how it works. Every year on your birthday team secretary sends you a card. And then you make a donation for BMS Health Ministries. It couldn't be simpler. These guys will tell you more.
Hello, I'm Helen Douglas.
Mark Hodgson.
Megan Chadwell.
Megan Barker.
I'm a doctor.
I'm a doctor.
I'm an occupational therapist working for BMS in Health Ministry.
And I want to invite you to consider being part of
the BMS Birthday Scheme. Through the BMS Birthday Scheme,
every year BMS raises over £300,000.
This money helps to support medical work by mind.
It makes our job possible, impacting the lives of the poorest and most vulnerable around the world.
There's so much more that we can do. In Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do something wonderful with your birthday this year by becoming part of the BMS birthday scheme. Your gift could restore hope to a spinal injury patient in Nepal, provide a loving home for children with disabilities in Thailand, or help with the safe delivery of a baby in Chad. To find out more, chat to your BMS birthday scheme secretary or visit bmsworldmission.org/birthday. Thank you. Oh, and have a very happy birthday.
So thank you to everyone who already supports the scheme. And for those not yet involved but interested in it, please go and see Elaine. And you can find out about how around the time of your birthday you can give a gift of life-saving medical treatment to some of the poorest and most marginalised countries in the world. And it's open to anyone at any age. So now let us pray. Father, thank you for the work of BMS in all capacities around the world. All who are drawn to doing your good work during times of human suffering. We pray that those in need of the help our gifts provide in their time of desperation see something of your light in the BMS carers and come to truly know and trust in you. In the name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ, Amen.
The reading is from Isaiah 58, and it's verses 6 to 12. From the New Living Translation. No, this is the kind of fasting I want. Free those who are wrongly imprisoned. Lighten the burden of those who work for you. Let the oppressed go free and remove the chains that bind people. Share your food with the hungry and give shelter to the homeless. Give clothes to those who need them. And do not hide from relatives who need your help. Then your salvation will come like the dawn, and your wounds will quickly heal. Your godliness will lead you forward, and the glory of the Lord will protect you from behind. Then when you call, the Lord will answer, "Yes, I am here," he will reply quickly. Remove the heavy yoke of oppression. Stop pointing your finger and spreading vicious rumours. Feed the hungry and help those in trouble. Then your light will shine out from the darkness, and the darkness around you will be as bright as noon. The Lord will guide you continually, giving you water when you are dry, and restoring your strength. You will be like a well-watered garden, like an ever-flowing spring. Some of you will rebuild the deserted ruins of your cities. Then you will be known as a rebuilder of walls. and a restorer of homes. Please join me in prayer. Holy God, God of righteousness and justice, we pray for your mercy. The words of your prophet Isaiah strike like a sword, a piercing light into our darkened lives. Our rebellion is exposed. Day after day, week after week, Sunday after Sunday, we claim to seek after you. Yet we continue to serve our own interests, and in so doing, oppress our neighbours, both near and far. We confess that we use our acts of piety to make ourselves feel good, to assure ourselves that we are Christians, to confidently claim that we are different from the rest of the world. But, as Isaiah says, we use our piety and fasting, and even this time of praying, to turn our heads upwards to heaven, while at the same time crushing the people around us. We walk around blindly, ignoring the hurt and damage we cause. As you say in Isaiah, the piety you desire, O God, happens as we contemplate the sinister ways the lives we enjoy may be wrapped up in hidden oppressions and secret violences. Thus you call us to loose the bands of injustice, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke, to share our bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into our houses, and when we see the naked, to cover them and not to hide ourselves from the needy. We pray that in your mercy, O Lord, you will go before us, preparing our eyes and ears to contemplate our own lives and actions so that we may discover the victims hidden from us, and repent of our sins. Then, O Lord, as your prophet declares, we may begin to see how your light shall break forth from our midst like the dawn, and your healing hands will work through ours. We will be given the profound gift of serving in your kingdom, participating in your work of redemption, joining our lives to yours, tasting the fruit of eternal life. Hold us in your grace, O God, that we may practice this kind of piety and this kind of fasting that bears witness to the justice of your holy embrace with which you hold the whole world. Amen.
We're going to spend some time in worship now, and we've chosen songs to make us think about the year ahead of us. I hope that we will be united as ever in our love of God, and that we will hear what God has to say to us and see where he's leading us, both as a church and in our personal lives and our personal faith in him. So let's stand to sing first of all, Take Us to the River.
Generation, for all the kings, the song of your
to have a one-on-one relationship with the Creator of everything. He sees the mess and mistakes we make, he knows what we think, and watches as we ignore him. But yet he still loves us and wants to be our Father. It's beyond our understanding, but if there's one thing you should do in 2018, it should be to accept his love and walk forward, knowing he wants to be with you more than anything else. Worship with a song that we've done a couple of times before. It's called Living Waters. The words are simple but so meaningful, and they're meant for you. Sing this song knowing that the words are for your encouragement. Take them into your heart and remember them as you go forward into the week. There our hope is secure. Do not fear anymore. Praise the Lord of Living Waters.
seat. So we invite Chris and Debbie to share a message with us.
So just before we share some thoughts with you, we're going to show you a little 5-minute video. And we really made this just to try and explain a little bit more of our life and what is it that we actually do. I work for this charity involved in healthcare and rural development, but you know, we're doing lots of other different things in our life. So hopefully this will just give you a little introduction to what we do. Welcome to the INF office here in Kathmandu. INF works across the west of Nepal in health and community development. We run hospitals and we work in rural communities improving lives. So Rebecca, what do you like about living in Nepal?
I like the range of opportunities that I get to experience on a daily basis, such as school events and stuff like that.
One of the things I've been involved in for the last 2 years has been supervising BMS Action Team, for young people who've come here for 6 months to work with us in various projects. And I'm here today with Rebecca, who's one of our current Action Teamers, and she's just been here for a month so far, so I'm just going to ask you, Rebecca, tell me a bit about your experiences so far. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's been really good. I've been getting to know some more of the local people, and then a little bit of the language. And then we're involved in lots of different projects here, so we've got one in a preschool, but we're going to get to the microclasses all the way from Nepal.
us as well. And it's, we've called it living generously, because that's what we're called to do as Christians, we're called to be as Christians, to live generously. And the verses that we've read from Isaiah are all about that, really. So we're going to just briefly explore those themes. But the first thing I think about living generously is that a starting point is being thankful. And we've sung about that, we've thought about that today, haven't we? Being thankful for what God's done. I was struck as we sang, Jesus Christ, I think upon your sacrifice. And the call it the bridge, the bit that goes, thank you for the cross, thank you for the cross. And it's just that starting point for our whole lives, really, to be thankful to God for what he's done for us. I met a man in Nepal recently called Abraham, but it's probably not his real name. Often when people become Christians, they choose a new name. So we've got lots of Abrahams, and the Nepali word for love is Prem, we've got lots of Prems, and they choose a new name, which is lovely, actually, that they put the old life behind them and they have a new name. So he's Abraham. And he was sharing how he was the first Christian in his village. And when he went back to his village for the first time and he said to his family, I'm not a Hindu anymore, I'm going to follow Jesus, his grandfather said, you need to choose whether you live in this village or you follow Jesus, but you can't do both. And so he chose to follow Jesus. And he said the first song he learned was, I have decided to follow Jesus. And he that was a few years ago now for him, but he was so thankful for the cross and what it had given him, even though it had cost him his family. So being thankful for the cross. And the verses in Isaiah and the prayers that we've had remind us that it's a whole life thing. It's not something we do on a Sunday when we come here and pray, but we're thankful. And I wonder, as you look back, especially the turn of a year is a good chance to look back on the last year, what are you thankful for? Maybe some people would just like to shout out things that you're thankful for, because it encourages all of us, doesn't it, when we think, oh yeah, that's a great thing to be thankful for. Well, have a think for a moment and I'll ask you that in a second. I'm thankful for friends. When we first went to Afghanistan, we did some language study, and then we lived in a small, remote town. And we felt quite lonely there. We didn't really have friends. And so now I don't take friends for granted in maybe a way I had before, because I'm really grateful for friends. And actually, the birthday videos, two of my really good friends were all there. I was like, oh. So I'm really thankful for friends and for good health. We don't have, we're talking with Linda about the NHS and all the problems. It's hard for us to access NHS when we're here. It's harder in Nepal for people that don't have an NHS. So we're thankful that we've got good health and we haven't needed to have that support so much. We've had lots of visa issues, and I'm thankful that the day before we came back, we got our visa for the next year. So that was great. So anyone, anything come to mind that you're thankful for over the last year?
Thank you for the home group, Marnie.
Home group. Yeah.
Thank you for my job.
For your job
working with children's teachers.
Right. Great.
Yeah. Thank you for Keith's help.
Thank you for
Keith's help.
Keith's help.
Yeah.
Great. So let's start as we think about living generously for other people and in the world, let's start to be thankful for these things. And the next thing which relates really is about having God at the centre of our whole lives. And God is our security. And in those verses we read, it talked about how God will strengthen us, he will guide us, he will satisfy us. And often we don't really quite trust that God will do those things, well I don't. When we came back from Afghanistan and we didn't really know what we were doing, it was really hard in that place of uncertainty to trust that God would guide us and satisfy us. But we can look back now and we can see that he did do that. But in the middle of it, it's a challenge, isn't it, to keep trusting God when we don't really know what's going on in our lives. sometimes we don't do that because we put our trust or our energy into other things, don't we? We give worship almost to other things. The word worship comes from an old English word, worth-ship. And when I heard that, I thought that makes me, it sort of helps me understand more, you know, when I'm giving worth to things. That can mean that I'm worshipping them. So as we think about what we give our time and our energy to, we can perhaps And these look like idols, don't they? They look like a big altar, and that's what it is. And these are all over the place in Nepal. You just walk down the street, and there's altars and statues all over the place. And people put offerings in front of them, and they walk past them, and they pray to them. And they're very, you know, to me, they look like the idols that are described in the Old Testament, the statues and the things that people worshipped. But we have our own idols, don't we? I don't think I've seen many of these sort of idols in Worthing. But we have other things that we give worth to and that take the centre of our lives where God wants to be. So I've got a picture, some things, some idols that we might have. It's just been Christmas, hasn't it? And we can get so absorbed in the shopping and the buying and the perfection of Christmas Day that we've replaced God with those things. We drove last week from Leeds to Scotland, where Chris's family live, and the roads were so clear until we got near Glasgow, near the shopping centre. And there's a huge traffic jam because no one can wait to get to the sales. And I love a bargain as much as anyone else. Don't think that I don't, but it's about, you know, keeping perspective and making sure that the desire for more stuff doesn't take the place of God in our lives. Or our homes. I'm sure this would be a temptation for me, and it's probably why God's made me move house so often, because it can't possibly be at the moment. But having a house that's perfect and looks so good and putting all the time and energy into that, it can easily replace the place that God wants in our lives. You know, if the house becomes more important than being able to invite people into it, then something's gone wrong, hasn't it? So being thankful and keeping God at the centre allow us then to think about how can we live generously towards other people. And Chris is just going to share a little bit more about that.
So that passage that we heard from Isaiah 58, I just really recommend if you've got a spare moment to really look at that passage, it's so rich. But basically what's happening there is the Israelites are saying to God, you know, we've really tried hard to find out what you want us to do. We've fasted, we've done all the right rituals, but still it feels like we're not hearing from you. We don't know what you want us to do. Do you know what God replies? God replies, well, go and serve the poor. And slightly strange reply, but he says, if you want to know what I want you to do, the way to do that is to serve the poor. And so, you know, we know that, I think we don't have to be a Christian to know that helping people is a good thing. But as I've read this passage, you can have a read yourself this week and see if you agree with me. But it seems to be saying to me that as you serve the poor and hand yourself over to what God wants you to do, in some way you yourself become closer to God, and you are hearing His direction for your own life. And it says that in the end of that passage that you will be a repairer and a restorer of things that are broken, and God will use you in His plans. So I think for us, when we were deciding whether or not to go overseas, one of the big sort of motivating factors for me was, you know, in places like Afghanistan and Nepal, there's real need, and I feel that God is calling me to try and help. And that was the same for Debbie as well. But you know, as Andrew said at the beginning, that, you know, that's, we're not even professional missionaries. we're all in the same game here. And I've heard just even in the last 24 hours of the homeless people here in Worthing and some of the work that you're involved in, that reaching out to communities, all sorts of projects going on. I'm sure there's a huge amount of work just represented in this room here and in your cafe out there. And I just want to encourage you at the beginning of a new year that that this is what God wants you to do. He wants to you to give of yourself. And actually, the word, the verb in the English is, he wants you to spend yourselves on behalf of the poor. You actually are reduced as you give out. And I'm sure some of you feel like that. You people that are year in, year out, week in, week out, spending yourselves, doing what you feel God is wanting you to do. And that's tiring. And we've experienced that, and I particularly experienced that in the last year. It sometimes just feels like, I don't know if I've got any more money in the bank to give out. I'm just right down at the bottom. But what it also says in these verses, if you read them, is there is the spending. I don't think there's any, my experience of trying this out my Christian life is there's no way to avoid the spending, but you know there are all sorts of promises alongside that. You know, he will make us like a well-watered garden with some songs of the river of life coming through us, and that is also his promise. So we need to give out, but also God will give back. So my prayer for you guys in this year and for ourselves is, as we want to put God in the center and push these idols to one side and give of ourselves, that we'd not forget the poor. And just lastly, I came across in Galatians that bit where Paul's deciding whether, or he's discussing with the other apostles whether or not it's okay for him to go out to the Gentiles. Do you remember that bit? And they have a discussion. He goes for a meeting, and they're all agreed. And the apostles just say to Paul, "But please don't forget the poor." And Paul says that I was never going to forget the poor. But you know, it's there in the New Testament as well, that we need to just put the poor at the centre. Okay. Oh yes. Thank you. It's okay.
So this is where have you come from and where are you going? It's from Genesis, and it's in a story which probably many of you know about a young woman called Hagar, and she's been really badly treated by God's people, actually, hasn't she? By Sarah and Abraham, and she's run away. And she's obviously not planned this very well, because she's run into the desert, and she's found a bit of a stream, and she's by the stream. And an angel comes to her from God, and this is what the angel says: "Where have you come from, and where are you going?" And I love this verse, because it reminds me that God sees us. He saw Hagar, and in fact, later she goes on to say, "You are the God who sees me." And whatever our situation, whatever has been going on in the last year, God sees us. And he asks us that question. Of course, God knows where we've come from, and he knows where we're going, and he knows what's going on, but he wants us to tell him, and he wants us to ask him to come alongside us. So I'd leave you that question. Where have you come from? What's been going on in 2017? What can you be thankful for? What have you learned? Maybe what are you running away from? Sometimes that's something we need to ask as well. But where are you going? 2018. Is God at the centre? Are there idols that you want to confess and say, "God, please help me to get you in the centre"? How will you participate in this call to serve the poor? How will you respond? So where have you come from, and where are you going? And Chris is just going to pray, and then we're going to sing.
So we chose, or Debbie chose the last song, which is called For Jesus. And really what I'd like to do is just use that as your prayer. To really in our busy lives for a moment before, before God. Father God, we are full of thanks for your goodness to us, your patience, and richness of your care for us. We just once again surrender ourselves to you, offer ourselves for this coming year. Please have your way with us.
Thank you. Please take your seats. So thank you, Lauren. Just a big thank you to everybody who took part in the service today. Particularly pleased that Chris and Denise at the back could take part in this. And I think that, you know, they do have a real heart for mission and fundraising for mission. So I'm really pleased you can join us today. So thank you very much. And also, Chris and Debbie, of course, I know it's true, but I always feel that in life most things boil down to people dealing with people. And I think to actually meet somebody and hear somebody, it really makes that connection. And that, both individually as a church, this, you know, today will help us focus on world mission and Chris and Debbie in particular in our prayers and giving. So I'll just finish off with a blessing. This is, I like to call it a Sussex blessing, which is written by the Bishop of Chichester. So take this off, I'm afraid. Thanks be to you, our Jesus Christ, for all the benefits you have given us, for all the pains and insults you have borne for us. Most merciful friend, brother, and redeemer, may we know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly.